إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. I'd like to welcome you for Tuesday class, and inshallah tonight we're going to be talking about the hijrah and migration of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is a very important and historical event that happened in the human being life, and especially in the Muslims and with the believers and the new da'wah that came in Arabia, in Mecca, that this event that took place, it made a difference between time of peaceful da'wah, if you can use this term, or the da'wah with the Quran, to take a different term or a different turn, to be a defending the da'wah itself with whatever means it takes. It is a great event because the da'wah is not anymore to be secret or to be waiting and begging for the people to be part of it, but to have a freedom that it can be open in public and to be given to the people, and even to have a station and a capital for them. The event of migration, moving from Mecca to Medina, the leader and the main purpose, the main person who is carrying the flag of Tawheed, which is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is a special figure that for him to be relocating from Mecca to Medina, it has a special mark and remark in the history of the Muslims. When we talk about migration, we're talking about leaving Mecca, which is the most dearest place to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also moving from the best land which whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen and selected to be the place for his secret mosque, for the Kaaba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by going to Mecca, going to Medina, which used to be called Yathrib, and after his migration, the name been changed from Yathrib to Medina, was not for tourism, or seeing a different scene, or seeing a different environment to relax from the fatigue of the da'wah, but it came as a result of the hardship and the difficulty and the persecution that the Muslims had faced, and being patient with it as much as they can, especially the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being from noble family and being the best of all mankind, he himself, he had faced a lot of hardship and a lot of difficulty and a lot of annoyance and disturbance. There is a difference between a member of the community and the head of the community. There is a difference between a regular soldier and the command of all the army. There is a difference between people in general and the man that been selected to be the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to be the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The persecution and the hardship that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through it, as well as the believers, it need a lecture by itself. But I'm sure that all of you familiar with what had happened in Mecca and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had waited and was so patient for how long? 12 years. One of us, when we have a problem and we deal with it for a month or two and became a whole year, became like, feel that you're going to be suffocating and you could not live, you could not take it anymore. Can you imagine that people live in persecution for 12 years? Can you imagine that people live in boycotting in between two mountains for 3 years? Can you imagine for somebody giving da'wah every day, day and night, for 12 years? This is a long time. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was example for us. So when we face with a hardship and difficulty, that we have to understand there is someone who is more dearer to Allah than me and you, and more noble to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than me and you, had faced a lot of hardship and a lot of difficulty, and he was patient with it. And the hardship, it take a different angle, special after Abu Talib had passed away, because he was giving him a lot of support, giving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a lot of support, although he was not a Muslim. And in general, the Arab respect Abu Talib. So even if they want to harm the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, still at least try to have some kind of concern, because his relationship, the family relationship between Abu Talib and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, with the leadership of Umar ibn al-Khattab, and after shura and consultation, they were searching for a way and means to mark or remark their events. Okay? So like you say, when did this happen? You say Monday morning, okay? But we are not talking about event, you understand, like every day, rush hour, every day, 5 days a week, okay? From 7:30 to 8:30, okay? We're talking about something made a big change in the Muslim Ummah and in the whole universe, okay? So Umar ibn al-Khattab, he had consulted and made mashura with the Sahaba about something, how we can know when such a thing happened. Some people, they said, the day when the Prophet born, or the year, which is the call Am al-Fil, the elephant, okay? Because there's a major event happening. Some people felt to understand with the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people, so they give their opinions, and after a consultation with the leadership of Umar ibn al-Khattab, they choose and selected the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be the main event to mark their calendar, and to know such a thing happened in the first year of Hijrah, or the second year of Hijrah, like this. Although the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't take place in Muharram, okay? And mistakenly, a lot of Muslims, they celebrating the new year, okay? When Muharram comes, because this is the Hijrah year. But the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it didn't take place in that time. It later on, it took place on the month of Rabi', and was in the Monday. Okay, so that means Muharram, Safar, and in the third month, this when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his migration took place. To be more specifically for those who relate by Christian calendar, that this was concise with the 622, okay, after the birth of Isa alayhi salam, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, okay, the 622, okay. So this is actually, for your knowledge, is not many countries that they go by the Hijrah calendar. And this is part of the occupation of the Western society to the Muslims world, okay? That things became by a different calendar, different time, different season, different celebrations, okay? So the Muslims, they lost their strength and their mighty by a different means, and they've been attacked by different means and different ways to lose their identity as a Muslims. But you found only few countries nowadays that they go by the clock. You understand? Like now, it's not, you understand, like you say, 7:30, all right? But this is almost now is what? 1 o'clock. So they go by sunrise or sunset, okay? Because this is the way how they make their time, okay? So Salat al-Fajr, okay, starting the day. And this is the way how their day goes. The migration, okay? The month, the Islamic month, Rabi' and Rabi' Thani, Jamad, like this, okay? But nevertheless, that migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 13 years after the da'wah. After a full 12 years in Mecca, now in the 13 years that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrate. What we mean by migrate? That he left Mecca to go to Medina. And this was with a order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had give him this order, as well as the believers also after him and before him to start to migrate, because this will be the new capital for the Islamic government and the Islamic state. So although that the Islamic Hijrah calendar start with Muharram, but the migration happened later on in 2 months and some days during Rabi' al-Awwal. This is something that we have to be aware about it, and also to understand that there is no any kind of celebration. Okay? This is came from the Christian practice, that people celebrating the new year and things like this. This is not, we don't have any Eid or any festival other than Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. We are living nowadays or these days in the year 1438. Okay, and I hope I'm right. 1438, which coincides with 2016. Okay, so this is the Hijra. That means we today talking about the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after 14 century, after 1400 years and some. Okay, you need to put a chair behind you in case we don't want the rug to get cut. Okay, you can go wash your face if you want, please. Okay, and for us to talk about migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a big subject. We can even take classes once a week until we finish 1 year to talk about migration and things that happened before and during and after. But I would like to try my best to highlight maybe 5 points tonight concerning the Hijrah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated. The Muslims, they left Mecca. They went to Medina, they established there. But today, after 1400 years ago, why are we talking about migration? Okay? Because there is some kind of migration today. We will talk about it before I end the class, and you can remind me. But there is lessons that is going to remain to be understood and to be taken as a lesson, as admonishment for us as a Muslims, and especially for the new generation, for the youth, for the Muslim Ummah, how we can benefit from the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was not to understand like something happened and it became like a story. And even people invented things. Like you say, he went in the cave, and after this, the spider came and made a web on the cave to what you call camouflage, okay, over the cave. And after this, a bird came and laid down some eggs. And when the kuffar came, say, no, no way he can be here, because if he went there, that this spider, you understand, web and all these things will be broke. These things is not true. Okay? So the people went in different, instead of learning lessons from the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by inventing stories, by making celebration, by making different bid'ahs and things like this. And the main lessons that in the Hijrah, you don't find too many people know about it. Okay. So we want to focus about one main lesson that today when we're talking about the Hijrah and the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we need to see how we can benefit and learn from the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number one, and all of us need it, okay, sacrifice, at-tadhiya. Okay, if you really want Jannah, you want Allah's forgiveness, you want to be successful, you want to be established in the earth, you want to be a people of da'wah and everybody understand, try to get into Islam, you're going to have to make a sacrifice. Okay, sacrifice is not something new to the Muslims, but is new to them. I'm talking about people who live nowadays in their deen. But they do it every day, knowingly or unknowingly. Okay? Staying after your job for a couple of hours, overtime work, because they give you $5 more additional to each hour. Alright? Moving from country to country to get your master's degree. Alright? working hard even in the weekend. So you work 7 days a week so you can have a nice house with a swimming pool in the back or in the front, wherever you want to put it, all right? Now they have it under the ground and have a special cover. I just heard a couple of days ago, somebody was telling me about father-in-law is going to have a swimming pool with temperature and cover and all these things. It's going to cost what? $60,000. Okay? This only is a swimming pool, okay? But anyway, people make a sacrifice every day. But when it comes about Islam, a lot of Muslims, they don't know. They are not ready to do this. As a result of this, okay, you find the masajid empty. You sound people coming to Jum'ah basically to catch the last raka'ah or the second khutbah if they are so devoted, all right? You find people selling haram stuff, okay? Why? Because they did not learn that Islam established on sacrifice. If you are not willing to do sacrifice, is no Islam going to be established. Is no establishment for the Islam or the da'wah. We see that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had left Mecca. He was born in Mecca. And you know, with our nature as a human being, we have attachment where we born, wherever this country, okay? And the neighbors and the kids who used to play with them and the corner shop or the convenience store around the corner from your house and uncle so-and-so that you see him, you understand, walking with the cane, going to Salat al-Fajr. You remember all these memories. Everybody grow in a place that have a lot of memories and this makes them attached to this area. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's a human being, okay? So he have attachment to a people, have attachment to family, relatives. He have attachment, you understand that the Kaaba is there, okay? And the Kaaba was there for Muslims and non-Muslims. The mushrikeen they used to make tawaf, okay? Those people, they still, because they inherit, they still have some memories from the teaching of the Prophet Ibrahim and other prophets, they had inherited these things. Although they still having idols on top of the Kaaba. So don't forget that the Prophet ﷺ has this a human being feeling and attachment, and his attachment also to the Kaaba, which is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, built by the Prophet Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam. Okay? So his family, where he was born, all the things, understand, friends, relatives, the Kaaba, for him to leave, as there is a difference between living in your own and somebody made a choice, you have no choice, made for you that you have no choice other than to leave. Okay? So we found that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was saying, what the meaning is, by Allah, you are the best land to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you most dearest land to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is what? The city of Mecca. Okay? Allah made it to be Umm al-Qura, the best, the mother of all towns. Okay? So you are the best and you are the dearest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I not been forced to leave, I'm not going to leave. So that means the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not left in his own. He has no other choice other than to leave. Otherwise, you understand, they're going to persecute him, to try to kill him, to plot against him, to stop the whole da'wah totally, okay? So now the Prophet have no choice other than to leave, okay? So this is something that we have to take it in consideration. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have to sacrifice the land, to sacrifice the Kaaba, to sacrifice his family's relatives, aunts, uncles, tribes, okay? Everything. And go to a place that he never been there before, all right? So this is one thing, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was willing to do it, to leave everything for the sake of Allah and to save this da'wah and take it someplace else. I want to give example with one of the Sahaba women, especially that we have all the sisters here tonight, okay, that I want them to hear, because the sacrifice is not only done by men. Sacrifice also can be done by women, all right? Our problem nowadays, that most of our children, daughters especially, their sacrifice, they sacrifice their deen, okay? Alternation in their hijab, in their mixing with the boys, with being distant from the deen, only have certain things about their deen, okay? But they are not willing, most of them, to make a sacrifice for the deen, okay? So they compromise the deen instead of compromising the dunya. So since we have all these sisters here tonight, let's give example with one of the ladies. Who? Ummu Salama. Ummu Salama now became, the migration became now a must upon all the Muslims. Okay? Some of the Muslims, they already went before the Prophet. Some, they left with the Prophet, like Abu Bakr. And some, they came after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Ummu Salama, she prepared for her migration. She is married. She has a child. And she's about to make a secret journey. Secret, that means honored by Allah. And secret also in secret, that nobody see, nobody know. But when she about leaving, departing, Abu Salama holding the rope to the camel, and Ummu Salama and her baby, Salama, on the camel, and they sneaking out, okay? And here, the family of Abu Salama coming and blocking his way. All right? His tribe. Say, listen, you are not leaving. You are not leaving. You taking our daughter. That means this, father-in-law, uncle-in-law, and all this, their in-laws. You are not taking our daughter with you. You want to go, you go on your own. Okay? But you are not taking our daughter, which is his wife. Okay? You want to go, you can go on yourself. But you are not taking our daughter with you. Okay? So now, who hear about this argument and debate and all things? Okay? We don't want the shaitan to start playing now. So now, who now hear about this debate and this confusion? The grandchildren and the tribe from the other side of the baby. All right? They say, okay. So now they start fighting over the baby. Say, this is our grandchild. Okay? You guys want to take your daughter, which is the wife of Abu Salama. Now this son is belong to us, and we're going to take it. So now they start fight over what? The first fight was about the family, and the husband and the son, and the husband. So they're going to separate who? Abu Salama from Ummu Salama with her son. Now, the other family come to fight over the son. Okay? So now they start pulling the child, and they snatch, dislocate his arm, and they took the child. So now Abu Salama has to leave by himself. Ummu Salama have to stay in Mecca, and Salama, the baby, have to what? Go with his grandfather and grandmother, you understand, from the other side. So one small family been what? this united to three pieces. But they have passion, they made the sacrifice with wind. And okay, you want to leave now, you can leave. Umm Salama kept crying and weeping over her child for a whole year. For a whole year. Finally, people interfere and intercede and they try to make, you understand, peace between them. After 1 year, they return the child to the mother. While the husband or the father also in Medina without his family. And now the Umm Salama, later on, she have to sneak out with her child and go to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to be with the Muslim community there. This is a sacrifice. Sacrifice upon the side of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sacrifice to the family of Salama. Okay? Let's see a man like Suhaib. Suhaib was not an Arab man. Okay? But he had migrated and he came to Mecca. So when they saw Suhaib is leaving, say, hey, where are you going? You man, when you came here to our city, you have nothing. And you came, made business here, and you have all this money, and now you think you're going to leave and take this money with you? No way. We are not going to let you leave, Mecca. You're going to stay here. So Suhaib, may Allah be pleased with him, and say, hey guys, let me ask you a question, okay? Those people are kuffar, but they used to honor their word. When they tell you, understand, they honor, they have respect. So when Allah chose this country and this place and these people in that time, because the qualities that exist in them, okay? Sorry for the interruption, internet. So Sahib tells him, what about if I give you all my property, this money that I made it in all these years, if I give it to you, will you let me go? Say, yeah. He said, take all the money. A'udhu billahi min shaitan ar-rajim. Okay. He told them, take all the money, okay? And he left. When he arrived to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said what? Rabiha Suhaib. Rabiha Suhaib. That your business, Suhaib, was what? Profitable. What kind of business? That he trade, gave his money to save his deen. And they let him with not even a dollar, okay? Not even a camel to ride. Everything. You want to walk? You walk with this t-shirt on your shoulder. Go ahead. But he gave, and the Prophet ﷺ, he told him that he is a profitable, he is successful, he's a winner, although he lost all his money. Okay? So we see that sacrifice was a main thing in the migration event. And the Muslims have to understand, without sacrifice, they are not going to be build anything. Sacrifice, you understand, it happened in time, in money, in houses, in jobs, in everything. So if the Muslims, they are not going to understand the necessity of sacrifice in their life, and that anything comes to contradict with their deen, they need to let it go and to hold to the deen. Okay, you can work here and going to be $15 instead of another halal. Work for $8. You take the $8 and you don't take the $15. Okay? Yeah, if you work with this, you understand, you get your citizenship, faster in 2 years you will get your green card. Otherwise, it's going to take you 6 years. No, let me take it 6 years. So you have two choices between dunya and deen. So you always have to bring religion comes first, and after all this, the material things will come a second thing. Okay? This is the first lesson that we need to learn from the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which has been demonstrated by the Prophet, by Ummu Salama, by Suhaib, and by all the Sahaba. Everybody has a story about what happened to them, but all of them, they put Allah and His Messenger first, and they said later. Okay, let's go to a second lesson. I hope the people in the internet still can hear me. I turn the volume down. Dr. So-and-so is busy. He could not tell us if I... Okay. We're taking a chance. Still they can hear? Okay. If somebody can hear me, Abdul-Rahim, maybe you can type one. No? You going to check me out? Okay. Your phone is getting too hot, so some apps have been closed. Help it cool down. It's fine. We're just talking about sacrifice. You can close whatever you want to close. Well, it's getting hot. All right, maybe it's getting... Okay. Give it a break. The second thing that we never lose hope, I already turned it off, Farouz, because they say it's getting hot and it's fry cooked. Wow, man. Look, how is it? Oh, like a fried egg, man. Never be defeated. Always have hope. This is a lesson that we have to learn from the Hijra. How we learn this from the Hijra? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had remained in Mecca for 12 years, giving da'wah. Okay? It didn't work that great. All right? One person, two people, one person. They go hiding in Dar al-Arqam. I turn it off. This okay? No, you are not sorry. Don't be sorry. Okay? I only... not broadcasting anymore on it, you understand, but the broadcast has been safe. It's good that we learn things through explain. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't get defeated. He didn't stop. Okay? He always having hope that it's going to work. You're talking about a year, 2, 5, 10 years, 12 years, and he's still doing it. He's not doing great. Only few people. Only one woman, one child, one man, no problem. Okay? Same way. They say, telling me about the class, saying, hey, you come, you, I give the class. So I bring Osama with me. I say, it's fine. If nobody, I put the mic and give. Okay? So a person, especially the da'iyah, you have da'wah, you have a mission, you believe in it, you have to stay fast with it. You have to keep with it. Okay? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became a prophet, you understand? With Iqra, how many people became Muslim? Only Khadija. Okay? This one. This it. Okay? Dar al-Arqam, done in secret, but still okay. You understand? They hide it. To such a degree, even when didn't work so great in Mecca and became even in public, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to go to where? He made a journey out of Mecca. He went to Taif. Okay? And the Prophet didn't have a donkey or a horse. I'm not talking about cars, okay? or a bug. You know the bug? Walking, can you imagine, you understand, going to from Mecca to Taif, you drive a practicing about like going from here to Charlotte. Can you imagine walking to a place like Charlotte or Greensboro? Walking. Subhanallah. And after this, after he makes this journey, he came with how many Muslims? With none. He came with a bleeding feet because they started throwing rocks on him, okay? Make him run away from the city. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam still having hope that when the angel Jibreel alayhi salam came to him and telling him that in his company is the angel of the mountains, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him to be subjected to his order. So whatever Muhammad, if you order me that I make this mountain collapse on the people of Mecca, I will do it. He said, no. He still have what? Hope. He said, perhaps inshallah, Allah will bring about a generation from the same those people who are kuffar, mushrikeen, maybe their children, maybe their grandchildren, they may be, inshallah, they be Muslims. You see? So the da'iyah have to learn always to have hope and to continue with his mission. Result is not yours. The fruits is not yours. That your job, alaykum salam, is to put the seed. Okay? And after this, if Allah wanted for it to grow or not, this is up to Allah. Okay? It's not your job. You know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that in the day of judgment, that a prophet will come and he have a group of people. And a prophet will come, because every prophet will come with his followers. Oh, life?
No voice.
Huh?
No voice. Salt mafia.
Oh, so you broadcasting, but there's no sound? Hell. Oh, you see, how are you seeing me? No, this is what I recorded.
You recorded before, maybe.
No. Anyway, if you insist, brother, we do it for you, okay? Yeah, it's got cool a little bit now. Are you a... Yeah, whatever it is. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, each prophet will come and they have what? His followers with him. And some prophets, he will come and he have two men followers. Mm-hmm. And the prophet will come, we have one follower, and the prophet will come, no followers. Can you imagine this? Why Muhammad Adli have to be sad that no students in the class? Only two sisters and five brothers, or whatever. Why? You always have to have a hope. You never know. You never know. Maybe one of the five that's sitting later on will become an imam. It's not by numbers. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Awaati nabi wa laysa ma'ahu ahad." One of the prophets will come in the day of judgment, have no followers. Can you imagine this? If me or you today, we try to establish some activity in the community or teach the people something, and nobody come and say, brother, forget about it. Nobody coming. So what? Why you worry about people to come or not to come? You believe in your mission, keep with it. Doesn't matter. You have one person, a sister, nobody. Do it. Keep your job, okay? This is something very important. We have to learn it from the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that a da'iyah have to be continuing with his mission regardless. He came from Ta'if, didn't work with him. To such a degree, he could not even enter Mecca. And he have to come in a protection, under protection of one of the mushrikeen. He say, hey guys, anybody touch Muhammad? As if he touched me. You touch him, you understand. This it. Can you imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entering back his hometown under protection of a mushrik? So, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continuing with all the things, trying, hoping that the da'wah will give fruits one day. And after this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to do what? Approaching people in different places during Hajj, Hajj season. Because the people who is making Hajj, although they are mushrikeen, but they know about Hajj and they respect the Kaaba, they come. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will take the season of Hajj for to speed his da'wah more, understand, and go to this tribe, this tribe, this tribe, and say, you guys, listen, I'm a prophet of Allah. I'm here, you understand, inviting to La ilaha illallah, and I am the messenger of Allah. And people keep rejecting. Most the tribe rejected him. At least 15 to 17 tribes. He didn't give up. Finally, in one of the years, the people of Medina, okay, which are the Ansar, they were ready. They were ready. They said, we will welcome you to our city. We will protect you. You come. Okay? So you can imagine, after 12 years of hard work, day and night, finally, the Prophet ﷺ will have a new place that can go and secure. Nobody can disturb him about what he's doing, and somebody will defend him. Okay? So, that you have to be always have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a way for his da'wah. Patience is something very important in the life of the da'iyah, and inshallah we're going to see one lesson more that we may can have for tonight out of the da'wah, out of the hijrah. And after this, inshallah, we may have another session concerning what we're supposed to learn from the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is the third lesson? What was the first lesson? Anybody remember? Surprise. Sacrifice. Yeah. Sacrifice. Do not forget this. And the second one was what? Always have hope. Keep with hope in Allah that he will give a new avenue for your da'wah. All right? So you keep doing the work. The third one we learned, the proper companionship, okay? Have the right person who assists you about what you're doing, okay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam been informed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and been shown that he's going to be going to another place and for him to get this kind of preparation. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had indicated this to his Sahaba and told them that I've been given in my dream where is the new location for our work, and is a place which is raised palm trees between two mountains. It gives them this description, okay? So this had gives them indication that Mecca is not the place for the establishment of the Islamic society and the Islamic state is going to be migration. So everybody start to think about this. So here, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, as soon he heard about this, he start to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to see. As he came, say, "Inni uritu dara hijratukum." ذات نخل بين لابتين. I've been shown the place your migration going to be in a place which have palm trees. Because you know Mecca is dry land, no green there. So the only cities you understand that they can think about it and with this description with palm trees, all the dates is Medina. So here Abu Bakr radiallahu anh, he said, should I go, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Said, slow down. Okay, hold down. I'm waiting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me the green light for this. So immediately Abu Bakr understood that is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam going to be leaving Medina soon or later, okay? So he start to prepare. He has two camels, all right? He start feed them properly, take care of them, and this talk about at least 4 months for this kind of preparation. And we see that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah gave him the order to leave, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had informed Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So he told him that I'm leaving. Abu Bakr told him, O Prophet of Allah, as-suhbah bi-abi anta ya Rasul Allah. May my parents be for the sake of saving your life, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I want to be in your company. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said yes. Abu Bakr was trying, he was not sure, but he had prepared, okay, the two camels for the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and now he making a proposal, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said yes. Aisha radiallahu anha said, فوالله ما شعرت قط قبل ذلك اليوم أن أحدا يبكي من الفرح حتى رأيت أبا بكر يبكي يومئذ. In collection of Imam al-Bukhari, Aisha saying, by Allah, I never know that somebody can cry with tears out of happiness until I saw my father crying that day, because he got so happy that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam accepted his companionship in this journey. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when the Prophet said, yes, you can come with me, he started crying. So Aisha, as a young lady, she said, I didn't know that happiness can make a person cry until I saw my father crying because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had accepted him for this. When they left Mecca, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was always trying to be in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes to his right side, move to the other left behind him, because he was so scared for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he's trying to save him to be the first one in case any emergency happened, like what they call nowadays bodyguard. Okay, so both of them, you understand, left Mecca, but this shows you taking the proper companionship in their deen, in their concern, in their loyalty. So when we do something and with somebody, you have to select who's the person that you can trust with the work. Who is the person you understand that you be close and open certain secret to them, or expose your work to them to know about what you're doing. So the selection of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, in the Hijrah, it teaches us that we have to learn to be in the right company and also select the right people for the right job, and to take this in our consideration, inshallah. To such a degree, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the ghar, to the cave, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to wait for him to enter first, in case there is a snake, there is a scorpion, there is anything to harm that will be happen to Abu Bakr, not to happen to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and said, O Prophet of Allah, wait until I make sure that the place is safe and secure for your presence. May Allah be pleased with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and all the Sahaba, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send peace and the blessing on his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah, we'll continue next week with more lessons of the Hijrah. It was my intention to cover 5 points, but inshallah we will do another session about lessons to be benefit from migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Jazakum Allah khairan. Thank you for being here tonight. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك ونتوب اليك. اللهم اسبس تفضل.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله